Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the session on of PM Open Space for January. My name is Mandar, and I would be your host for today. We have a packed agenda. So, in first 3 4 minutes, we'll do some context setting, run some quick polls, and then look forward to hearing from the speaker in the next 50 odd minutes. Quick logistic checks. There are two tabs that you'll see. One is chat section, another is Q&A. We would recommend you using Q&A section to put forward your questions. That helps us organize them better. Avoid chats for Q&A. Thank you. A quick overview of PM Open Space industry practitioners community for people who are uninitiated. So this is a community forum which was started to get real-time inventive answers, hear stories from trenches of projects and programs, and organize community events as well as interact with each other through the online community groups. It is spearheaded by Bangalore chapter with supporting organizations like Hewlett Packard Enterprise, Huawei Technology India Private Limited, ABB Ability Innovation Center, SAP Labs India Private Limited, and UST Global being part of the core team. A quick snapshot of organizations which are here today. We'll just run quick poll. We thought we'll hear from you about yourself and the project health. So we'll run like a poll for next minute or so. If you can just fill in, that will be nice. We see a lot of responses coming in. Would appreciate if others can fill in. Again, thanks. Think we'll continue with the session. So, thanks again for helping out with the polls. So, here is where we actually get to the crux of this session, which is about a presentation from Mr. Anshu Gupta around the role of individuals in rethinking the society. All of you know about Anshu and Team Goonch. But I will do a formal introduction. He's popularly known as Clothing Man, and is recipient of 2015 Raymond Magsaysay Award. Anshu Gupta ji founded Goonj with a mission to highlight some basic but ignored needs of people on development agenda. Particularly, he was using clothing as a metaphor. He is an Ashoka and Schwab Fellow for Entrepreneurship. And he creatively and flexibly matches and seamlessly weaves urban surplus into changing priorities and realities of rural marginalized communities. Under his leadership, Goonj has taken alarming growth of urban waste and turned it into a tool to trigger large-scale work on various rural development projects. Anshu has also added dignity as an important lens to define development for people. Over years, Goonj has done massive disaster relief and rehab work pan-India, which most of you would already be aware of. He studied mass communication apart from doing master's in economics and started as a freelance journalist. left corporate communications job in 1998 and initiated Goonj. And as I said, it's a accomplished biography, so it will probably take me another 10 minutes. But instead of me doing that, let us hand it over to Anshu sir. Welcome, Anshu Gupta ji. And while he comes on stage, I will just play a short video.
सुनो, हमने तो कभी नहीं कहा कि जिन मकानों में तुम बसे हो वो हमने बनाए हैं। हमने तो कभी नहीं जताया कि गाड़ियां दौड़ती हैं तुम्हारी जिन सड़कों पर वो हमने बिछाई हैं। हमने तो कभी बोला ही नहीं कि जिस रिक्शा में तुम बैठते हो वो हमारे फेफड़े खींचते हैं। मैं जानता हूं ढूंढ रहे हो मुझे उस बंद नाली को खोलने के लिए, वो फैक्ट्री की बेजान मशीनों के लिए, रात को जागते रहो की आवाज के लिए, गाड़ी पर जमी मिट्टी को धोने के लिए। और मुझे पता है बाबूजी को मेरे हाथ के ही गोभी के पराठे पसंद हैं। तुम्हें बर्तन धोने से कितनी कोफ्त है। हम तो अब भी सोचते हैं फिर जाने क्यों दिया, क्यों छोड़ा सड़कों पर, क्यों बस और ट्रेन बंद थी, लाठियां क्यों चली हम पर, क्यों चले हम हफ्तों तक भूखे प्यासे। हमने तो कभी नहीं कहा कि हम सिर्फ काम पर याद आते हैं। हमने तो ना स्कूल मांगे, ना सड़क, ना गाड़ियां, ना पक्की छत। फिर एक बार इशारे से फोन करके आवाज देकर रुका तो होता इस अनचाहे सफर से पहले।
नमस्कार मंदर, शैल आई स्टार्ट?
यस सर, ऑल योर्स।
ओके, थैंक यू। थैंक यू फॉर अटेंडिंग दिस फ्रॉम ऑल अक्रॉस, एंड आई थिंक आई विल नॉट स्पीक मच, बट बिकॉज आई वुड रादर गो मच डीपर इन द क्यू एन ए। एंड यू नो दीज डेज दिस स्मॉल फिल्म विच यू जस्ट सॉ, मेनी टाइम्स व्हेन आई डू सेशन आई मेक श्योर दैट वी रन दिस स्मॉल फिल्म, because this is just a reminder. So today I'm sitting in Bihar. I was in the field for about a week, and today sitting here and went to a large number of villages, and then you really see that, you know, whole lot of people who came here, who were forced to come here, and they're also again forced to go back. And this particular film, what happened, I don't know how my poet came back in this particular disaster, because in the last 2 decades of this life, with a number of disaster, and because there is some kida somewhere inside of journalism, so I often travel with my camera, and as I've been saying that I must have captured huge amount of disaster, distress, destruction, everything. But this particular disaster, when you talk about the pandemic or the displacement or the migration or the forced migration, that somewhere really, really hurt like anything, because it was every other disaster you go and you see, you know, some broken buildings, houses, you know, collapsed bridges, people crying, whole lot of other things you ultimately see in that, and you see a large number of dead bodies also in every single big disaster. And this is one disaster where you didn't see the dead bodies, you didn't see any house collapse, any bridge collapse, and you still saw so much of distress. And somewhere, you know, although I mean, right from the beginning we as an institution became very active, I'll come to that a little bit later, but I think it's all about individual as of now. This particular session is about individual and rethinking as individual about the society. Samir, I felt very cheated. I felt very, very sad about it. I felt that maybe something wrong has happened. That, and this is the hardcore and the fundamental wrong which maybe we have done in this society, and maybe in our arrogance we will never accept it, because we don't want to question, we don't want to answer. We don't want to answer that why did these people really walk? What happened? How come they never trusted any official, any government, any leader, any corporate leader, any society, social leader, even the neighbor? And they started walking. They started walking back to their homes. They belong to, and to be honest, many of us were feeling very safe because we were at home, we were with our near dear, and they were just trying to go back to those people. But my question in this entire journey was, have we really built a society which does not trust each other? Is there a huge amount of deficit of trust in the society that you are actually not trusting your next door neighbors? All these stories of, you know, I remember Noida, it happened, a friend shared that how the RWA really kicked out an iron guy, press karte hain ghar mein. And then after a few months, when this family came back, they all three of them, actually the husband, the wife and the kid, had to go through a COVID test at their own cost, despite the fact that for the last 4 or 5 months they were not earning. And then they were getting entry in that society. I've been questioning that from people, that, you know, a large number of people asked their house help to leave. Although the fact remains that, you know, we never had any risk from the house help because she has been staying at our place. Rather, she was at risk because we were going out and we were bringing this disease in. So how does this operate? How does the society operate? How have we accepted the fact that people who made house for me, in which I'm safe for the last almost an year now, those people remained homeless. And the people who have been feeding me, you know, rice from rice, wheat and all kind of, you know, good stuff, they remained foodless. And then in our whole lot of programs and initiatives, we call them beneficiaries. I think the important realization for many of us is that we are the constant beneficiary, because farmer is one person in this country who never gets the minimum wages. I mean, we don't need the economist for that. But the day we start paying minimum wages to the farmer of this country, most of us will not be able to even touch rice. So we are the constant beneficiary of the people. Same pulses which we bring from them, we polish, we give it back, and then we call ourselves donor and call those people beneficiary. It's all about language, it's all about lenses. So it has started somewhere breaking. And I said that, you know, how do we really rebuild this society? How do we really understand that something went wrong in terms of trust, in terms of relationships, in terms of respecting each other, in terms of respecting self-respect of people, in terms of taking care of the dignity of people? It was absolutely amazing and beautiful to see that how the common citizen of this country and the NGO sector and a whole lot of other institutions came up, and you know, the way people were feeding, the way people were risking their life, they're still going out, cooking food, delivering that, or whatever essentials. I mean, we have seen hundreds of those cars where, despite all odds and curfews, almost curfew, they were opening their dickies of the car and just trying to, you know, reach out fruits and everything to the people who were walking. That is the other side of the society, which certainly tells us that there is no dearth of good people in this country or in this society, and a lot can be built. But to come back, and you know, what story or what narration I'm giving today will very soon become out of context. Large number of people just remember those images as images, and whole lot of us are not even worried that where are these people right now. I mean, the people who are walking on the roads hundreds and thousands of kilometers, where did these people go, and where are these people as of now? Because it's just going out of memory, and maybe that is one of the reasons that whenever we do any session these days, and maybe I'll make sure that at least for the next year or two, we will keep running this small film. This is a part of a complete poetry called Kovidi, which has started. I started writing that time, and a friend Kirit just picked up, and then this small clip was made, just as a reminder that COVID or this pandemic did nothing new to us. It just exposed us, and it exposed us in a very, very brutal way. it told us that all the big buildings, all the big airports were of no use. Well, the PHCs, which we ignored, the public health centers, which we ignored, are the most useful, you know, thing in this country. It told us that Air India is still relevant because that is the airlines which was actually bringing people from outside in those days. It told us that we certainly need to be much, much more careful about the ignored issues, about the ignored spaces, about the ignored people. Municipality worker, we don't care, but they cared for us. Food delivery people, we don't take care, but they cared for us. I mean, there is a notion, and as I always say, ki roti.com banane se roti nahi milti. I mean, you don't get roti by creating roti.com. But we still live in that notion, you know, because we are privileged people, we order it on online. We don't understand that someone is growing potato, you know, when you get a burger, someone is growing potato physically, someone is cutting it physically, someone is cooking it physically, someone is delivering it physically. It is only people like us who can order, but otherwise every single thing is physical about it. We never, maybe many of us never valued those delivery boys and the girls, and then we saw that they were risking their life. We saw how small government hospitals, which are completely ignored in front of those, you know, private hospitals, which are now charging 20 lakh, 25 lakh rupees or 15 lakh rupees, any, all kind of obnoxious amount, you know, amounts for treating a COVID patient. But look at the entire government health system, which has been completely ignored by this country. And actually that was very important for all of us in that life. What message this pandemic, gave us, only if we remember, is that there are ignored communities, there are ignored issues, there is which we don't care, and there is some other way of living life. It's extremely important that going forward, we understand what is family all about. We understand that what is this fabric, the society fabric all about. We understand that how the ignored things really become much, much more important when a disaster happens. And if I talk about my journey, and then we will open up for the Q&A. Long back, almost two decades back, and before that, to be honest, when I came from Dehradun to study, to do my mass communication, and that was a time when, you know, I used to roam around on a scooter in Delhi, and Delhi was a big city. In Dehradun, we had never seen red lights in those days. We had never seen organized bagging. And in Delhi, when you come, you actually, stand on a traffic light, and suddenly you see some kids, some people coming and asking for something. And as a almost new young kid from a small town to a big city, you wonder that what is this happening? You know, from where these so many people come, and why these kids are not wearing anything, especially in winters and shivering, because you don't understand the I will not say marketing, but the important part of it, whether you call it marketing or whatever, because if you wear enough clothes, maybe people will not give you anything. But most important part, which I didn't understand, was the compulsion part of it. That if people are there on the road and they're shivering, it's also a compulsion. It's not just by choice. And you know, the winters have started troubling me somewhere, just because of the clothing. And then one fine day, just to share the story, story of the people whom you saw walking, one of those person, right? Now I can relate back in a very decent way after this entire displacement. And when I, in my lifetime, at least, and in most of the us who are listening today or will talk today, must be the first time that we saw such kind of, you know, numbers and such kind of distress when people were walking. So almost of the same, you know, same person, Habib bhai, I met him. He was basically running a rickshaw on the roads of Old Delhi. It was a thela. And as a person in, say, with a camera in hand, I just followed him because I didn't have a zoom lens. So if you have to capture the close-up, you actually go nearer to the subject. And then when you go near to the subject, you find in Hindi written on his rickshaw, Lavaris Lash Uthane Wala Delhi Police Ka, which means a person who picks up unclaimed, abandoned dead bodies for the local police. Very strange thing, you know, I mean, never imagined that someone is really, really doing this also. Followed him, he stopped somewhere. His blind wife, Amnaji, was sitting in that rickshaw. They stopped somewhere and they just walked a little bit, found a dead body, picked up, put that in the cart, covered it with a piece of cloth, and started again driving back. And I actually sense as if the robots are working. You know, there is emotions are less, practicality is much, much more. Exactly, people know from where who will hold and all that kind of thing. And I had seen a huge amount of dead bodies before that in my journey in Uttarakhand when the earthquake happened, and that was my first exposure to any disaster or any village life. So I'd seen enough dead bodies there, but in the city, I'd never imagined like this. So started spending a lot of time with him. One complete week, early morning till late night, used to follow him. Used to have my food, breakfast, everything with him on the footpath of outside LNJP hospital. And I think at the age of almost 20, 21, I really realized what is footpath all about, what is migration, how people come, from where do they come, how they go through a miserable life, and then they go through, you know, the settlement. And when they go through this settlement process, before that, they go through a miserable phase, and a lot of people die due to lack of food, medicine, care, accident, suicide, all kind of things. And Habib Bhai was paid 20 rupees and 2 meters of white cloth per dead body, for every dead body he used to tackle. Obviously, a very strange profession. So when I started talking to him, two statements came up. Many of you must have heard it in some other session, but I'm just repeating it. Habib Bhai said, ki saab jaadon mein mera dhanda badh jata hai, aur kabhi kabhi itna kaam hota hai ki mujhse sambhalta nahi. In winters, my work goes up, and many times I have so much of work that I cannot handle it. And you'll not believe, I found that every 24 hours in the range of 4-5 kilometers where he was able to take his rickshaw, he was actually picking up 10 to 12 dead bodies. And in the summers, it used to be 4 to 5. And like all of you must be, I'm just assuming, I also thought that cold is killing people. Till the time I realized that actually cold is not killing people, because if the cold kills people, I would have died. If I survive on my scooter 10 p.m. in the night while coming back from Habib's place at the speed of 50, 60, 70 km/h, and someone static on the road or under a footpath or on a footpath dies, it's actually not cold, but lack of clothing. Because till that time, I never knew that you talk about three basic needs of humankind, you say roti, kapda, makan, but we never speak about clothing as a subject. Cloth is a disaster relief material. So you actually need a flood to be flooded with clothes. Cloth is a charitable subject object, something when you don't need it, you want to get rid of it and you want to give it to someone. I mean, that's how the entire clothing thing happens. And although the fact remains that cloth is not about weather, cloth is about dignity, cloth is about basic need. But even if you talk about the development issues across the globe, from Millennium Development Goal to Sustainability Goal to CSR to whatever, you will never find clothing written as a subject. So see the irony. On one side, three basic need, roti, kapda, makan, food, cloth and shelter. On the other side, most important development issues to work on, clothing does not even matter. And the subject, unfortunately, cloth is the first visible sign of poverty. And not only poverty, very unfortunately, very absolute unfortunate, that we even decide who is skilled, who is not skilled, who is cultured, who is not cultured, educated, uneducated, this caste, that caste, just on the basis of cloth. And then we move on with that. So realize that, you know, it's not even a subject. His daughter, who is now unfortunately no more, but at that time a little girl of 5, 6, 4 years, Bano, who gave the most shocking statement, very well documented in the leading magazines of those days, when she said, ki jab mujhe thand lagti hai, to main lash ke saath chipakkar so jaati. She further said, lash tang nahi karti, lash karvat nahi badalti. When I feel cold, I hug the dead body and sleep. It does not trouble me, it does not turn around. Can you imagine that something so gruesome, on something so important in life, but something so grossly ignored as a subject? It has never been a development subject. And that's how this journey of Goon, which you spoke about, started. Left my job in 1998. I was with the Scots and then started. To be honest, now people call you social entrepreneurs and what all, but I often tell people, especially the new startups and people who come to talk, and I always tell them that time I didn't even know how many E's come in entrepreneurs, because that was not the idea. The idea was that you just see a problem. So two ways to do it: either you keep cribbing and you keep finding a fault and keep saying that someone else will do it, or you just have trust on yourself and start something which you don't even know what will happen. I mean, if I see my first memorandum of association of Goon, the cloth is not even written, because we didn't even know that you have to register this institution, or there is an institution what we are starting. So we started very small with about 67 units of personal clothing. Against the normal misconception about Goon, we are not in the business of collecting and distributing clothes. That's unfortunately, a lot of people think that that's what we do. We don't do that. We deal with almost 6,000 tons of material right now, which is the mix of cloth, utensils, footwear, old doors, windows, anything on the earth which can be reused, repurposed, is accepted by us, and to the tune of 6,000 tons now. We post-COVID work in about 26 states, parts of 26 states, couple of 100 districts we reach out to. And the larger work area is not only the slums of India, but the village India. In nutshell, I'll just tell you what we are trying to do, and then we'll open it up. We're just trying to change the lenses and language, to be honest. So when you say that I want to donate cloth, or I want to donate shoes, we object. And we say that, the fact remains that if we are talking about second-hand material, which we have already used, whatever it is, we are actually not donating it. So we should not create a halo around us. We are discarding it. So the only word which is appropriate is that we are giving it. And we need to be thankful to every single person who is using our second-hand material, because that person is actually the keeper of our emotions. That person is the keeper of our heart and money. We are not. I mean, we just don't want it. That's why we're giving it. The fact also remains that if the so-called poor, which I don't agree with, we always tell that the people are only financially poor. People are not poor. Some people might be financially poor. You can imagine that if the financially poor people do not, exist, 70-80% of our material will actually go in the landfill sites, the way it has been happening in all other so-called developed nations. How developed they are, I think the pandemic has certainly exposed them also in a very, very big way. Whether they agree, whether they shun their arrogance or not, that's a different topic. Maybe we can talk later about it. So in a way, the people are helping us by using their second entity. The other important part about the lenses and the language, we said that the biggest asset of people who do not have money, like suppose people like us who have a little bit of money and we are asked to make a list of our asset, we can certainly make a list where we can list a small house or a big house, or a couple of cars or some mobiles, laptop, whatever. But if you talk about the financially weaker section, I believe, and we've seen it, that one of the biggest assets with the people is their self-respect, is their dignity. I mean, if you talk about begging, you don't find beggars in the villages. Begging is a city phenomenon. Begging happens in compulsion. Begging does not happen by choice. So we do not have any right, if we want to rethink about the society, if the virus has really, really has been able to make any dent in our thought process and has been able to tell us that how privileged we are. I am privileged right from my birth. When I was not, born in a Musahari family of Bihar, or I was not born in a particular caste community geography of this country. And I was certainly, born in a so-called caste community or some better geographical area. I'm actually privileged by birth. And when you are privileged by birth, you only add privileges in your life. And when I was born, privilege in my you know, in my life, when the life started with that, where I had no control, over it. So that's why we said that rural communities have much, much more dignified life. Self-respect is their one of the biggest asset. We have no right to challenge that, that biggest asset or that self-respect. Charity somewhere needs to be killed. Sustained charity. Instant charity, sudden charity is absolutely fine. Someone is hungry, it cannot sustain, because charity kills dignity. And without dignity, you cannot talk about the development. Also, I feel that with all good intentions, and I'm not doubting on any of my statement, I'm not doubting on intention of all of us. It's just that we have to relook into what we are trying to do and how we are trying to do something. We all are trying to do good. I agree with it. Charity might be a beautiful subject, favorite subject of the doer of it. But have we ever asked the receiver of it whether that person also likes it in the same way? And you can try it out and you will really find that the larger answer is no. Because for every single person, self-respect is important. So our model is just the model of dignifying giving and dignifying taking, dignifying receiving. We do not use the demeaning word like donor and beneficiaries, which unfortunately this word uses a lot. And today we are in a webinar. If I would have been in a seminar with all of you, I would have done an exercise. So normally what we do, we ask people, in front of us, and we pick up a couple of people and say that next 5 minutes, just speak a para. And in that para, you actually have to speak about and use the word donor and beneficiary a few times. 100% cases so far, whatever we have done this exercise, even webinars we have done it now. When people start talking about donor beneficiary, it is something like donor and beneficiary. I have never seen any person who really says beneficiary or donor. And my question is that if we start this conversation or this work by keeping donor here, and so-called beneficiary here, and then go to them and talk about equality. How does it operate? Or how will it happen? How will we think that we will really achieve it? So we said that there is no donor, no beneficiary. Every single person is a stakeholder, because in this world, every single person can contribute a lot. What that person contributes is a different issue. Whether we value or not, that's a different issue. But if we value that, you can really have multiple currencies for work, and large number of people to work together. Simple model of good, 6,000 tons of material come to us. As I said, variety of material goes through a very, very rigorous process of sorting, processing, if needed, repairing, washing, packaging, and then matching the need of people who really need it. Because one of the biggest problem with the donation mindset is that we give what we have. We do not give what people need, with all good intentions, fine. So if after Odisha cyclone, Gujarat earthquake happens, which happened in the history. Odisha cyclone, we were giving chana, gur, and rice. But Gujarat earthquake, which happened in Kutch, hardly any people used to eat rice. They were looking for bajra or the local food that time. So after a certain point, it becomes a wastage. Or when the tsunami happened and large number of people from North India send their sweaters and monkey caps, thinking that disaster has happened and people need woolens, without even understanding that in Chennai, people do not need that kind of woolen or the monkey caps. So you were trying to do it with the good intention, but you are not putting in extra effort. It's not that if you, when we travel in our life and we go to various places, we actually spend about a few minutes in finding out the weather, what to pack, how will be the temperature, whether I need woolens, I need mufflers, whatever. But unfortunately, when the giving happens, we largely give what we have. We don't understand that people actually need a different thing. So we started developing this model where we said that we will really, really match the needs. So if we have more caps, we will actually send it to Odisha, because Odia people love to wear caps, in those areas. If you are working on food, we dealt with almost 5 million kgs of food in the last about 8-9 months, which we reached out to the villages. But we are very careful in just matching the need. We said that chana dal, it's absolutely fine for the northern India. But if you go to southern India, it has to be Tur Dal, because and you know, price wise or whatever, it doesn't make much difference. But in terms of acceptance, in terms of you know, those minute detailing, it matters a lot. And it doesn't lie on the road there, anything, because in any case, in a beautiful country and a diversified country like India, and where we enjoy diversity, in the development work, it often becomes a problem if we do not localize it. I'll give you a very simple example, and let me come back to the clothing. If I talk about women clothing today and what we collect from urban India, it is largely jeans, t-shirt, pant, ladies suit and all. But when you talk about rural India, it is actually sari, blouse, petticoat or the traditional dress. So there's a huge gap. If I talk about urban males like me, we all are 32 to 40. But if you talk about the rural males in the country, large number of them are still between 26 to 30. So it is shape, size, culture, geography, religion, whole lot of issues. So we just started working on that. So all this material is converted into a large number of kits. There are family kits, marriage kits, which support hundreds of marriages, Anganwadi kit to support large number of Anganwadis, office kits, which support a small institution to, you know, create their offices, a school kit for the kids, all that kind of thing. And then it goes to the villages. And what we do in the villages, nothing goes free. We don't charge people because money certainly is an issue with large number of people. So the model has come up, which is called Dignity for Work. We used to call it Job for Work. People will pick up an issue or many, many issues. So a village will come and say that we desperately need a connecting road. Other villages say that we have a river, but we don't have a bridge, and we can certainly create a bamboo bridge. Someone will say that we want to dig a pond or dig a well. The other village might come and say that, no, we don't have to dig a well or pond, but we need to recharge our pond. That pond has not been in use for the last many, many years because hand pumps are there, which are now drying up because we are not recharging the, you know, the ponds. And that's how the village community really get to their own work. So if you have to make a bamboo bridge of a couple of hundred square feet, we are not bringing engineers from the cities, because we know that there is a huge amount of wisdom in the village. This is a country which unfortunately call farmers unskilled. Without understanding that people who can really come out with 100, 200 variety of rice are actually not skilled, but the most skilled people on this earth. People who can add two kalams or two different variety of mango and create third different variety of mango, and we all enjoy that, and we still call them unskilled, that's our foolishness. I mean, if someone does something in IIT, that person is an innovator. And if someone does something in the village, that person does it by jugaad. How does it operate? This is the language which is distorted, where we need to correct, you know, somewhere going forward. So people really get together, they do these huge activities. If I pick up the data of last financial year, it's almost about 400 kilometers of roads in the village India, which are made or repaired in a big way, just by this particular activity. So people do this, and after a few days of work, people receive this material with a lot of dignity. So some certain things happen, and I can, you know, clear it more in the Q&A. The biggest strength of India called Shramdan, the community labor, is back in a very big way in the community space, number one. Number two, traditional strength of India called barter economy is back, you know, in the last two decades of this work, with two new currencies. On one side, it is the urban underutilized material which would have gone in the landfills and all. So obviously, it saves a huge amount of environment. And on the other side, it is the local wisdom, local resources, local shram, local hard work in the process. So it is a barter between these two new currencies, and money is for the logistics of it. Third, most important part, that the decision making is now gone in the hands of people. It's not like people like us who will go and say every village will have a road or pond, but people who are going to be the recipient, one part of the recipient of this particular work, they will decide with what is needed. So if, I mean, the fact remains that a village has now a choice to decide that road might be important, but we need pond, because pond as of now is a priority. So the decision making is in the hands of people. And fourth important part, that entire giving is dignified. If you go and give a trouser or shirt to someone and say, this shirt belongs to me, the person will say, yes, it is yours. But then the person makes a road and you say it belongs to me, the person will come back to you and say it might be yours, but I've earned it. So that language, that narration, that thought process is changing by using secondhand goods or secondhand material or the wastage of society as catalyst or as a tool for that. So that's the whole model. And now in this process, one very important thing which has happened is that, you know, we have been able to lay the pipeline or the grid in the country. As I compare it with the optical fiber, and we say that, you know, the telecom people did that and they led those optical fiber all across, and then they are using it for multiple purposes. Now we also laid the pipeline across the country of the relationships, logistics, you know, having local knowledge, finding out where do you get the best samosa and the litti, you know, when your field worker goes, which is a place where you can stay in 200 rupees, 500 rupees, 1000 rupees, or which is a safe place. And maybe I think that grid was very, very helpful for us when we you know, got into this COVID response work, because there were relationships, there were hundreds and hundreds of partnerships with the units of Indian Army, Border Road Organization, Panchayats, local community-based organizations, local innovators all across the country. And on the urban side, we had relationship with the corporates, with the schools, individuals, resident welfare associations and all. And that's how this entire work really, really scaled up. And as I said, almost about 5 million kgs of ration itself, plus other material which has reached people. Except first 1 month, nothing went as literally as just distribution. We have been able to really, really develop huge amount of kitchen gardens to work on water bodies and everything, exactly the way we were operating before pandemic. So I think I will stop here. But what I just need to say that this is very important for all of us to understand that virus has given us a chance to relook into a lot of things. Not only the virus told us that 4 t-shirts are good enough in life, not only the virus told us that if you do not do pocha you know, in your house for 7 days, it is fine. So we have no right to trouble a lady who comes to our place to sweep our floor and do the jhadu pocha and bother her on a daily basis, even in the cold winters, do a pocha. Although the fact remains that when we were doing it ourselves in the lockdown time, we were hardly doing it. The pandemic has really told us that ultimately, a large number of ignored people come for our rescue. Not the most known, well-known big people or big hospitals, but maybe my next door neighbor, who, because I personally went through COVID way back in May itself, and then after many colleagues, a lot of people in the family, and we have seen that how that is small grid of friends or well-wishers really was much, much more helpful than anything else on this earth. You know, if you were going out to take money from your ATM, police was there, you know, in many cases to beat you also, unfortunately. But there were people who were serving food outside also for a large number of people. So I think this is a time that we make sure that we do not remember what this invisible virus tried to teach us, and we do remember that there are huge amount of learnings, right from having some time with the family to taking care of people around us and people taking care of us. And the fact also remains that somewhere a lot of us should have guilt going forward, and if we are rethinking about society and ask ourselves that what went wrong that these millions of people है कि हमें रोका क्यों नहीं अनचाहे सफर पे जाने से पहले. Why did you stop us, you know, before going in this on this unwanted journey? So I think in that context, certainly we need to rethink about the society and rethink about our individual roles and appreciate that if we all do a little bit and if we all do much, much more, a lot can change, you know, in this country also. Am I audible now? And
yes,
I'm stopping here and open for Q&A. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're audible, sir. Are you able to hear me?
I am.
Yeah, this was definitely an inspiring talk and eye-opener for me personally. And there are a lot of questions which are coming in. So one question I see is when any person thinks of charity or service, they're left without knowing what to do. And so just give money or blindly donate things and it might not be useful. So how do you propose they reach out to your organization to do something meaningful?
Listen, reaching out to our organization, you can always write to mail at goal.org, refer our website and all that. But most important part is that we are not the only organization who is trying to do good. I think this country is full of absolutely wonderful, amazing people and initiatives. Let's have a lot of you know, trust, and let's also take some extra steps. I always tell people that there are two ways of doing this. Ek aap door baith ke patthar maro aur dusra aap jaake you become a part of the process. I would really urge everyone to become a part of the process. I actually told a lot of my corporate friends that you guys really, really missed a huge amount of opportunity. I mean, every time large number of corporate come to us and they ask the voluntary opportunities that, you know, they want their employees to come as volunteer. And I've been asking them that when people were really, really needed on the road, why were you not taking any, why were you saying that it is risky and it is against this, it is against that? You should have really, really be helpful to your employees, because large number of employees as individual wanted to contribute. They wanted to even volunteer. I mean, on the roads, large number of people who were, you know, supporting some people were also working with some corporate, some agencies, some government, somewhere. But it was sad to see that a large number of institutions didn't support their employees to volunteer. So please have a lot of faith, in the system. Pandemic has reaffirmed that. For goonj.org, mail at goonj.org distribution. But I would again say that there's no dearth of good people who are trying to do something good. And reach out to them as much as possible. Spend some time with them to really understand the core philosophy and the way they are working.
Thanks, sir. There's one more question, an interesting one. You may have faced it. So Vasudatta says that just one thought, when you take up such development work in villages, have you faced challenges dealing with local politicians as they might perceive this as intrusion in their area and taking mileage away from them?
So I think it's a package deal. I will not say that everything happens without challenges, but the challenge or these kind of crisis is certainly a part of the journey, because journey has to be like this, you know. A flat journey is a flat ECG, which is not good. The journey really has to be like this. We do face challenges, but one thing please remember, that if your intentions are pure, and if you work directly for the people and people are with you, lot many of these things can be handled. Plus, if you do a work, if you do some meaningful work, but you're not worried about the inauguration of it, the life becomes very easy, because a large number of people who are power hungry are not that eager about the work, but they are more eager about the inaugurations of that. So we don't do inauguration. We don't do those tent house work and the shamianas and the big pictures and all that kind of thing. We very silently do it. One of the core philosophy of Goonj, personally also and institutionally also, has been that there are two ways of working. One is that you talk about the work. The second is the work talks about you. Second one takes a lot of time. You need a lot of patience, but it does talk about, about your work or about you at a later stage. I think we have taken up the second stage. That's why the challenges come, but we've been able to largely face those. I don't remember in the last two decades of working in thousands and thousands of villages every year, and also in the slums, that we have not we were not forced to run away from the places. You know, it took in many areas it took much more time to have people with you to make sure that the opinion leaders do not bother much. For sure, contractor lobby is not liking us. This we have seen now of late, because when you do such large scale infrastructure, water sanitation work in the village, somewhere contractor lobby thinks that they are exposed or their work is taken up. But in any case, they have the full opportunity, because we are not doing any concrete work that way. We are making a kacha road for the village, which is or a kacha pond for the village, which is absolutely fantastic to use. But the governments, the local politicians, the contractors have an opportunity to make it pakka, inaugurate, and put their names. And they can certainly do that, and they are doing it. Many of them are doing it.
Thanks, sir. One very short question. What is your message on individuals' role in today's society?
One very simple thing is that now, right now, we, to be honest, we do not need thinkers anymore. We need doers, we need action, and each one of us really need to play this role. We should not just look forward to the governments or the social sector to do something good, because doing good is a collective responsibility. And we really need to understand that if something happens good in my neighborhood, in my locality, it is my life which becomes better, it is my life which becomes safe. I mean, if I go to my next door and work for an year or two on making sure that there is a proper garbage disposal system in that slum or in that area, it is my drain which is not choked. So I'm actually telling people, a lot of people, that, you know, if you want to do good in the society, be absolutely selfish and understand that everything you do good in the society helps you, helps me, helps all of us, not only the last person, right? If the life of village people becomes better, you will get better products from there, you will get happy people from there. The distressed migration will not happen. Even I am migrated, fine, I migrated from Dehradun, but I will never be called migrated. The people who are forced to migrate and who do not come by choice, who come by compulsion, are unfortunately called migrated, although I am also migrated that way. So this is like a loop. Very simple question from all here, which I again often do in my sessions. I ask a very basic question, that tell me the safest place in your life, right? And large number of people, they you know, raise their hands, and then they say home, ghar. Then I ask another question, which I'm asking also today in continuation. And I'm saying that how many of us leave our 10 to 12 years old daughter alone at home? And then you experience an absolute pin drop silence. And that's what I ask people, that what kind of myth are we living in? Why are we earning so much? What will I do with, you know, membership of 4 clubs in Gurgaon or Gachibowli or wherever? If my daughter is not safe in my place, you know, which I made from my hard-earned money, for which my father really, you know, made, or my mother made a lot of sacrifice so that I really study well, and then I work well, and I made a house for myself. And if my daughter is not safe there, what is this? Am I really understanding it? Do I understand that if my daughter is going out with earplug and trying to walk on the road, is not putting the earplug because she's so fond of music, but she's putting earplug because she doesn't want to listen to the bad things? It's extremely important that we have to build the society, we have to rebuild the society on much, much more trust and much, much more action. It's important that I stop the people who come and make a road in front of my house, about 8-10 inches of that cement road, which is happening all across the country now. They make that road, and then after a few months, they again come back to me and say that you live in the low-lying area. Listen, I'm not living in the low-lying area. My house was absolutely at the perfect place. It is you who made a road, you know, outside my house, didn't even talk to me, and I didn't raise a voice because I thought some road is coming up. I didn't know that with road the flood water will also come. In the last 5 years, what has happened to Bangalore, Hyderabad, Mumbai, Delhi, we all know that, and these are the big cities. These become news. It is happening every day in Darbhanga and Patna and whole lot of other cities all across the country. But it is basically the rampant and the corrupt construction which is happening. And I'm not becoming a part of that dialogue. I think I'm sure that I don't have to fight with someone, but I if I become a part of the dialogue and see my responsibility, you know, and say that, okay, fine, I'm selfish, it is affecting my house, that's why I need to talk. But then I need to talk. And a lot of things can happen, a lot of things can be solved with the conversation. You just have to, you don't have to get into the conflict mode always.
Sure. Thanks, sir. And then a lot of folks here are technologists at heart, in the sense they have come from technology background. And also the question here is, how can we as a program managers or engineers, technologists help the cause?
My suggestion to all of you, because this is something which very commonly we keep getting, you know, but my suggestion to you is that if you are a technologist, you are not only a technologist. You have hundreds of different skills which you don't even know, which you have never explored. So if you really want to work with some institution, whether it is Moonj or many, many other institutions, which we can also refer, you can also Google, you can also talk to your friends and find out. You spend some time with them and they then see that what skills does it make. So there is the possibility that exactly your technical skill one institution might not need, but maybe you are also a guitarist with that, you are also a painter with that, you are also a copywriter with that, and that organization might need that as a prime thing, and then your technical skill as a secondary thing. Treat yourself as an individual with a lot of skills, not only technical skills. I mean, that's my message to all my tech friends all across, that imagine yourself as a human being who has huge amount of talent of various kind. Technical thing is just your technical knowledge or your education or a little bit of your experience. But go with an open mind and spend time with the institutions to understand. Don't go with the solution. Go with the learning mindset and then see how much magic can happen.
Thanks, as we will take some last questions and all. I think there's one interesting one on the, and people are appreciating your choice of words, particularly how do we treat people with dignity with usage of the right words. So do you have any recommendations on the word usages, something that we can follow in our daily life or when we are interacting with others?
Only use the word which you are absolutely happy when it is used for you. So when you say, I want to help you, okay? When someone says, that person want to help you, do you really want to hear that? Do you want to hear the donate kind of stuff? I mean, because the most important part for all of us is the dignity of people. So whatever you give, whether it is about material or it is about the narrative or it is about the language which we use, that should, the first parameter or the barometer of that is that it should be acceptable to me as an individual. Then only I should speak that. I mean, I should only give only the material. I mean, you will not believe, we get in 6,000 tons, we get a huge amount of absolutely beautiful, perfect material. But we also get the used sanitary pad to blood-soaked undergarment in that. Right? Because this is the same country where many of us get up from the dining table by saying ki ye rakh do yo XYZ khalegi, keep this XYZ will eat, and XYZ is our household who's actually cooking for us every day. So, and this is inherent. This is a part of life. You do not even think twice that your 4 years old kid is really listening to this. And that's the practical learning for that 4 year kid. So when that 4 year kid becomes 15 year or 20 year or get a job and operate in the same way, it is actually not his or her fault. It is the language which I spoke. It is the narrative which I built. It is my action which that kid is following. Right? So you have to be very careful. What is acceptable to me as an individual, that is the only thing which I should give in any shape.
Thank you, sir. We are at the fag end also. So just any final words from you? Obviously, it has been inspiration talk for me. I think it has been fairly good. And from the time I interacted with you, fairly down to earth, sir. Anyway, last words from you.
Okay, I think the In my opinion, let me just talk about the next couple of years now. Those couple of years are extremely, extremely important in the life of millions and millions of people. And as I said, that I'm sitting in Bihar, and before that I was just in Uttarakhand. And we spend a lot of time with the villages here, because that's our term bhumi in any case. What we all need to understand, if I remember about myself, my parents made a lot of sacrifice, and to the level that they didn't even buy, despite a government job and all, they never bought a vehicle for themselves or whatever in those middle class, honest middle class days. And that's how they spent a huge amount of, their earnings and all in our education. And that's why, we are here. So the credit actually goes to them. Similarly, in this country, millions and millions of people, their entire generation, has sacrificed this life to make sure that their kids study, because in Indian villages and small slums and all, you do not have good education facilities. So they are even sending them all across the country, hostels, very tough times. When people used to call Goonja Development Organization, I always used to object, and I still object. I always tell them that we are not a development organization. The development happened from 0 to 10. And 0 means couple of pairs of clothes, couple of, times basic food, a little bit of education till at least, primary. The fact remains that for the last 2 decades, we have been working with the people who live on the minus level. So it is, that's what I've been telling you and myself also, that minus to 0 is actually not development, but survival. And to sustain, survival is very important, is the most important thing. I mean, if you survive, you sustain. This is the time when, because of this entire, virus and economy and displacement, large number of people are pushed back to minus or maybe much deeper. Do not think by giving 10 kg of rice to someone, our duty is over. We certainly, certainly need to constantly work for next couple of hours, next couple of years, to make sure that more and more people again start struggling to come back to zero, if not to the plus level. And that is where me, you, each one of us can play a huge amount of role, take out a substantial part of the earnings which you have, material which you have. I'm being very upfront on this. And it's not an appeal for Goonj, please. I am here because of Goonj. I'm not here for Goonj. Please remember, right? Whatever I am, the credit goes to Goonj and my parents. But I'm not here for Goonj, and I'm not asking anything for Goonj. Very important that whosoever you loves it, where you see the direct impact, right? In the year or two, right? It's not about, so direct impact does not mean immediate distribution of something. Direct impact is very thoughtful plan also. Just take out a substantial part of your earnings, your savings, your material, your home, and give it to people as much as you can. This is the first and the most important step which each one of us can take. It's not only about the material which we don't need. It's not only about the extra money which we have earned. It's about a substantial part of our own stuff, because last point mera hai Mandar, and it is about my self-realization way back in 1998, when I realized that in the institute where I studied, the fees was only a couple of thousand rupees or a few thousand rupees. And ideally, it should have been maybe even in those days, 50,000, 1 lakh rupees. And then I asked myself that, was it possible for my parents to pay? And the answer came no. And that day I realized that I am the biggest product of subsidy of the country. And this subsidy comes to me from the labor, from the farmer. So this is the best time in our life the virus has given us. We earlier also had the same issue. Now this is much deeper, much larger, that we pay back this karja of the people very silently, not for the Facebook picture, but for feeling good, for doing good. I mean, that's what I hope, that's what I want to build up as a movement in this country. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Again, inspirational talk. Appreciate that. So as the next step, I will invite on stage Ms. Priya Batra. So she is Director Special Programs with PMI Bangalore Chapter. So let
thank you, Mantar.
Yeah, just give me a minute, Priya. I'll just share the slides also.
Sure.
Can you see the slides? Good.
Yes, Mantar. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can.
Sure. So first of all, I would like to thank the core team for making this event happen and run the entire session seamlessly. So thank you, everybody on this call for all the efforts that you have put in to bring this session to life. And then I would like to thank the audience for joining us today. Please know that your participation is one of the main source of support and encouragement to bring speakers to you who can influence our thinking and change our belief system. So we really value your support and your participation. Thank you again for joining us today, really. And Anshu, coming to you. It's really not easy to thank the speaker when one feels exposed to the extent, which I'm sure all of us are, after the video and after what you shared with us today. And words are not really sufficient, Anshu, to express our gratitude for the time and information that you have shared with us today. I believe all of us see enough pain and misery and less privileged people living in very challenging circumstances, which is beyond our imagination. And most of us can feel the pain and we have the ability to sympathize. But there are few, Anshu, very few, who actually gather the courage to go beyond the feelings and emotions and take some solid actions. And Anshu, you are the example that helps us today to take the reality check that I feel for you is not enough. I will do something for you is what the ask of today is. And I thank you again for being you, what you do, your unwavering commitment and devotion to your work that really inspired us today. So thank you again for accepting our invitation and we thank you again from the bottom of our hearts.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Over to you, Mandar.
Thanks, Priya. I think by now the final poll and the feedback on the session would be available with all of you. So I would appreciate if you can take a couple of minutes of your time and just respond to the poll. Some final announcements while we move on. There are PDUs that you can claim. I think there was a chat question there. So this is a PDU that you can claim. And then an input on the next session. So next session, I think most of you will be aware of Train 18. It's something where we are talking about exploiting Atmanirbhar spirit, right? So we have Mr. Sudhanshu Mani, former general manager, Integral Coach Factory Chennai, who would lead us through his Train 18 experience.
Hi, Mandar, can I leave?
Yes, sir. yes, sir. Okay, I'm stuck.
Thank you all.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate your time and thanks everyone for joining in. We'll close for now. Bye-bye.